What's going on, Bigger Pockets? It's Matt Faircloth. So one of the things that it sounds complicated that a lot of people talk about on BP and in the real estate world is the 1031 exchange. What a 1031 exchange is, let me explain briefly what a 1031 exchange is, and then we'll talk about mistakes that people make in the real estate in the 1031 exchanges. I made one that was very painful. I talk about it in my book, Raising Private Capital, in detail, but I made a major mistake on a 1031 exchange that I'll tell you guys about in a second. Here's what a 1031 exchange is, okay? Let's say I own a piece of real estate right here, okay? And that's a lovely little home here, and I decide, hey, the market's gone up, or for one reason or another, I'd like to sell that piece of investment real estate. This is not a fix and flip. This is not a property I lived in, or not my primary residence. This is an investment property, okay? And it qualifies as an investment piece of real estate. This could be a single family home. This could be an apartment building. This could be a strip center. This could be anything, as long as I can show that I held it for investment intent. That was my intention on the property, okay? I have to be able to prove that I held it for investment intent. Okay, so I sell the property, okay, right. All right, if I didn't do a 1031 exchange, that sale would create a taxable event. I'd have to pay income tax on the money I made. So if I made $100,000 in the sale, good for me, great. But I might have to pay short or long-term capital gains tax on that. If I want to avoid that tax, a 1031 exchange allows me to take the profit from that sale and roll it into something larger. Let's say I buy myself an apartment building. I buy myself an apartment building, or I buy something else, or whatever. I buy a strip center, or I buy something. It doesn't have to be a residential property. I can sell a residential property and trade into something commercial or whatever. There's a lot of rules. This video is not about the rules around 1031 exchanges. This is about mistakes that people make. But in general, it can be other types of real estate. General rules are, as long as I hold the property in the same name, so if this is under the name of Matt Faircloth personally, right, which is not what I would want to do, I would hold it under, Matt Faircloth LLC, or the DeRosa Group's the name of my company, or something like that. But as long as this property is held in the name of an LLC or 123 LLC, this needs to be held under the same name as this one, okay? And all the proceeds from this need to get moved from here to here. So if I made 100K, okay, all 100K needs to be here. If I sell this property for 200,000, this property has to get purchased for more than my sell price of this property. So this could be for 201, or it could be for $1 million, whatever, okay? Whatever it is, this has to be more than this one, and I have to roll all the profit over, and the name of this has to get held in the same entity. Those are the general rules. And let's talk about the mistakes. And that's what a 1031 exchange is before I get to the rules. The 1031 exchange allows me to take the profit I made here and roll it here, and I defer the tax. It's not tax-free, I just defer the taxes. So I may have to pay taxes when I sell this. I may have to pay it if I 1031 into a big thing, then I might have to pay taxes when I sell that, unless I just keep doing 1031 exchanges until I pass on and my heirs inherit the property, and then a lot of that deferral gets wiped out. Talk to a CPA more about that for more details on how you can defer taxes all the way down the line until you pass away, and that changes the tax structure altogether. Talk to your CPA about that. It's beyond the structure of this, beyond today's video, but that is an interesting conversation. Something that should get noted that falls into mistake number one, okay, is when I sell this property, day of closing, let's say I sell it on January 1st, 2019, okay? I then have 45 days, okay, that I have to identify the new property. Okay, I have to identify this property within 45 days, okay? If I don't identify that, then I fall into violation of the 1031 exchange. I have to identify it to the IRS and to the 1031 exchange custodian, and I have to document that I'm saying, hey, this could be the property I want to close on. And I can identify multiple properties and only close on one of them, but bottom line, if I don't identify in 45 days the properties that I want to trade into, then I'm in violation and I lose the tax savings, and I'll have to pay capital gains tax on that $100,000, okay? Now, the next timeline here is 180 days. Now, people get this confused, and this is a mistake that people make that all falls in with mistake number one, This is 180 days that I actually have to close. Okay, now I have to identify it here. This is actually called nominating. So at 45 days, I have to identify the property, which saying, I think it's gonna be 123 Main, I'm selling 456 Second Street, and I'm gonna buy 123 Main Street. That's called an identification. So identify this property or nominate it as one that I'm going to buy. I actually need to close on it, okay, in 180 days, okay? Now, some people think, and wrongly, that this 180 days begins at the point of nomination. That's not true. This 180 days actually begins, and this is a big mistake people make, it begins here, at the time that you sell this property. So this is property one, this is property two, okay? When I sell property one, the day of closing, I now have 180 days before I have to close on property two, or I lose this. There is no extensions, there is no way to, you know, work around it. You gotta close on this within 180 days or you lose that tax advantage, okay? So the number one mistake that people make on a 1031 exchange, and let's just call a spade, if you mess up this timeline, it's because you didn't clearly understand it or you didn't clearly plan for it, is breaking the timeline. Okay, breaking timeline looks like not identifying or nominating in 45 days. Or not doing the 180 day window to close on this property. And it's clearly because you didn't understand it. And that's okay, but you broke it and you have to pay tax, right? The way around, and I'll give the mistake and I'll give the way around it, okay? The way around this, okay, is by when you put this property up for sale, it's not like you get surprised by the closing date of you selling the first property, okay? Once you put it up for sale, you know that at some point you're gonna sell, you're gonna close, and this 45 day time window begins. So what you really wanna start doing is at some point, this is you standing here and you're having the thought saying like, you know what? I think I'm gonna sell this property. I think I'm gonna sell that property. So when you have that thought, that moment here, way before the closing date of this property, that is when you start looking. Okay, because you buy yourself, what is this? This is at least another 30 to 60 days that you can buy yourself, that you start looking for this property. If you start looking for this property at the day of closing, you're gonna be under the gun because you're only gonna have 45 days that it's gonna take to close this, okay? In the 1031 exchanges that we've done, we had this property identified before we closed this, right? And in some circumstances, we had it under contract. Okay? And so it's very easy to do that. If you start looking the second you have the thought of selling property A, if you start looking then, you can very likely find property B well before this closing date. You can nominate and close very quickly and this timeline collapses real fast. But you gotta start looking here, not at the time of closing, okay? Now, mistake number two that people make on 1031 exchanges is that they don't clearly use the right custodian. Now this money gets moved from here, gets held by a third party company, okay? The money gets held, and this person holds the money, and then when you're ready to close it, they give it here, okay? If you use the wrong custodian that doesn't understand the process either, or that is someone who doesn't have a good reputation, or someone that's whatever it is, if you choose the wrong custodian, this person, and unfortunately in the United States, the custodians are not a well-regulated industry. It doesn't take much to become a custodian of people's 1031 exchange capital, and so it's a very, very low bar. It should be something that causes a lot of regulations to do, and a lot of licensure and insurance and things like that. But unfortunately, it's not. It's something I believe we're working on in this country to hold these people to a higher standard. But it's very easy today to become a third party custodian for people's capital. So what that enables people to do is for folks that are maybe not the highest scruples or not the best decision makers, or maybe people that are just straight up bad actors or, you know, criminals or whatever, to get into being 1031 exchange custodians. It is the most source of real estate capital theft is 1031 exchange custodians. And it's a bad thing, and it happened to us. We got involved with a 1031 exchange custodian that had really great marketing, really great testimonials, a really great profile out there. And they had a strong presence online, but we ended up selling a property, rolling capital to a 1031 exchange custodian, and it turns out they were a bad actor and they were running a Ponzi scheme. So we ended up having to litigate, and we're in the middle, still, this is a year and a half ago, we're in the middle of collecting the capital that they locked up as a 1031 exchange custodian. They had a strong presence, they were vetted, we spoke to other people that they worked with. You have to be very careful on who you work with in that situation. What I didn't do is to check to make sure they were bonded and insured. But I interviewed several people they had worked with, I checked out their website, I'm a people person. But what I would have done differently is to check out the insurance, or just let's just say the mistake you make is choosing the wrong custodian. Okay, choosing the wrong custodian is a major mistake, and that just means not doing the proper due diligence. It's not vetting their insurance, not doing all the due diligence you could do on this party, because you think that the mistake that people make as well is they think that, well, if they've got the license to do it, they must have a certain level of insurance. They must have been vetted, but unfortunately, it's a low bar to get into it, so no, unfortunately not. It's very easy to get into this position as to be this person. And so it's very easy for someone who's a bad actor to get into that position, unfortunately. So, we talk more about that situation in my book, Raising Private Capital, and we're in the middle of settling with that party. They're not going to get away. We're going to get our money back and then some, from them. So, thank you for your concerns, but we're good to go. And I learned a lot, and I'm happy to share with you guys what I learned out of that experience. So, number three, the third thing, the mistake that people make is just in general misunderstanding the rules. And this isn't a general, just in general, it's two different ways you can misunderstand the rules. The first thing is on timeline, but I've seen people try and do 1031 exchanges and try and find a way to take a few of those dollars out for themselves. Can I take a few dollars out to put in my pocket? Or can I use that, take this money, some of this money and use it for the down payment on the new property? No. This money needs to live with the custodian. You can't use it for anything except for the actual closing activity when this property changes hands. Okay? So it's just misunderstanding the rules. Okay, misunderstanding the rules. Now, breaking timeline is also a misunderstanding the rules, but when I say misunderstanding the rules, I also mean with regards to the money and with regards to the second thing that happens is, let's say me and three investors get together and buy property one. So me and two limited partners or people that invest privately with me or something like that, whatever it may be, and we sell this property and only two of the three investors want to get into this property, or only one investor, like let's say this is a syndication and I take my shares of the syndication and I want to take it and not have to pay tax and roll my syndication profit from here to here, whatever it may be, you can't take, if you own shares of a company or shares of an LLC that owns this real estate, that cannot be transferred as a 1031 exchange into this. It can't be done. If some of your investors want to get out when you sell this and some of them want to stay in, unless the investors buy each other out and the only people that are left are the people that want to stay in before you sell this, those things can't happen either. So I've had many, many people, because we do syndicate some apartment buildings with people that have bought shares of larger assets with us, and they say, well, when you sell the property, I don't want to pay taxes, so can I take my shares of your company and do a 1031 exchange when you sell it and roll it into something larger and not have to pay tax? No, unfortunately you can't do that. The only way that you can do a 1031 exchange is the LLC that owns this company transfers its ownership into the new property. That's the only way you can do it. And people misunderstand that, or they plan on taking their proceeds from this as part of the partnership and transferring it into this. This is all part of misunderstanding the rules. All these things can be done by doing the right research, okay? Can be answered, these problems can be avoided, that's what I'm trying to say. These problems can be avoided by doing the right research, breaking the timeline, choosing the wrong custodian, and just general misunderstandings on the way the transfer has to happen, or trying to use part of the money for your down payment or for your due diligence, for any of the things that you need to use that money for, you can't touch it until the closing date on the property. So you can't use any of this money for a phase one environmental study or for an appraisal or any of that kind of stuff. None of that money can get used for this. That is just a misunderstanding by you not doing your homework, okay? The bottom line for 1031s is, yes, they're complex, but they're extremely lucrative. If you've got a lucrative sale and you don't want to pay tax on it, and you and all the other owners of the property are all on board, 1031 exchange can be phenomenal wealth builders by allowing you to transfer the property, your proceeds tax-free into the larger piece of real estate. A lot of the big boys and girls of real estate do them, and so I highly recommend you look into that, but make sure you do your homework and don't trigger one of these mistakes that people make during 1031 exchanges, okay? Lots of questions you guys may have about it. Please ask them in the comment section below. Love to chat with you guys about 1031 exchanges more, or talk to you about the bad situation we got involved in, and that I'm happy to talk to you guys more about that as well. What do you guys want to get into? So let's chat more about 1031 exchanges in the comment box. Please do that. Thanks for watching, guys. Have a great, profitable week.